You're listening to Salvo City Radio 94.4 FM with your host Jimmy Petruzzi on the Friday Sports Show, bringing you all the latest news from around the world and the local area. Our aim is to increase participation of sport and awareness of different sports, and today we have a sport that I'm certainly really passionate about. The English public, the British public are really passionate about athletes. We're going to get an insight in terms of how things are developing in the world of athletics. And we have Nick Settle, who's the club support manager of the English Athletics Northwest, who's going to give us insight into the great work they're doing and hopefully give us a bit of insight in terms of what people can do to get involved and whether they participate or on whatever level that they can. So, Nick, welcome to the show. Great to have you on board.
Thanks, Jim. Thanks, and thanks for having me as well.
No, it's great stuff. And on this show, one of the aims is to sort of increase awareness. We bring guests, world-class athletes and different sports people from around the world, but also many different people who work in different disciplines in sport. Athletics being a huge sport, this country has a huge tradition of fantastic athletes, and it'll be interesting to see and get some insights into what happens behind the scenes to make it all happen. So what's your role, Nick? You're the club support manager. In and around this area, we've produced great athletes. What's your role? Now, what do you do, and what's the vision for English athletics according to what you do?
Okay, yeah, great. So probably just to start off, there's 12 of me nationally, support managers across the UK, well, across England. I've been in position for about 5 years now within England Athletics. I cover the whole of the Northwest bar Cumbria, obviously we're going to have a chat about kind of the greater Manchester Salford area today. I probably have around about 130 clubs which I support and look after. England Athletics are an affiliated body, so we get clubs to affiliate nationally. We've probably got around about 1,400 clubs affiliating to us each year, and athlete wise we've probably got 180,000 approximately around there. My role is probably a bit like Ron Still, really. It does what it says on the tin. I'm here to kind of support and develop the local affiliated clubs in the Northwest region. So that could be, I see my role kind of split into three different types, really. So you've got kind of a bespoke project. So any clubs coming to me, where it might be, say, facility support, structural, governance, safeguarding and welfare and funding advice. So that's kind of one aspect where I would go in and sort of spend some time with a club and offer some advice and support within that. We've got kind of servicing clubs, so that could be kind of a bit of a light touch where they might drop me an email, say, hey Nick, we need some resources on a particular item, so I'll direct them to kind of a quick resource or a useful link. I also kind of set up coach development workshops locally in the Northwest, and I call them club open forums, but they're a bit like a networking opportunity. So we've got one actually next week, on Monday the 3rd of February in Haydock. So we've got about 20 clubs signed up to that, and we're going to talk about volunteering, so how to recruit and retain volunteers, and then also we're going to talk about kind of the transition from being a youth athlete to a senior athlete in a track and field section, as well as for the road running scene we're going to talk about setting up a junior section from scratch. So that's quite a hot topic with the road running scene within the England Athletics family. So we've got kind of three really nice topics for clubs to come in, share some ideas with each other. So we've got a couple of guest speakers from local clubs to come in, share their good practice, and then we'll open up the floor and see if there's any other good practice within the room, which I'm sure there would be. Probably the final piece of the jigsaw would be club reviews, we call them. So I would go into a club and then I would help them facilitate a bit of a review to sort of see where they are now and where they want to be. So it's a bit kind of sort of setting up like a little mini kind of development plan for the club. Yeah. So they might want sort of a wider going back to kind of the bespoke projects, is probably a little bit more detailed approach to that. So they're kind of the three elements what I help the clubs within the regions.
Really interesting stuff, Nick. I find it really interesting the role that you do, and obviously there's a lot of work involved, no doubt. And you know, you mentioned the number of clubs that you support. Now, one thing that's sort of interest, I'm sure listeners will be interested in, is in terms of the rivalry amongst the clubs. You support the clubs, but equally in saying that, is there, or do the clubs see, is there rivalry between clubs? Are they sort of, in terms of producing athletes, in terms of recruiting athletes, and is that something that sort of, in your role, you sort of come across, Nick, or are you sort of focused more along the lines what you mentioned before, coach development and helping support the clubs as they sort of get in touch with yourself?
My kind of remit is to help the clubs from behind the scenes, so yeah. Kind of structurally in place. So have they got kind of the right constitutions in place? Have they got the right policies and procedures, yeah. and structures and so on? When it comes to kind of rivalry, obviously there's going to be a bit, like within any sport, there's going to be a bit of rivalry with competitions and so on. But I do think it's pretty good within athletics, as in, yeah. You know, there's got some good banter, and the clubs are quite close. So we've got kind of three large clubs in the Salford area. You've got Salford Mets AC, you've got Salford Harriers, which are kind of the track and field athletics clubs. Then you've got Swinton Road Running Club, who are more off-road and off-track even. And then you've got a new affiliated club, which is called Barton AC, which are out of Shack Ladies Gym. They're really, really new affiliated club, and they're more towards the road running scene as well. So there's kind of four different clubs for the Salford residents to pick from the area, and all three larger clubs, they all use the athletics track in Winton, in Eccles, mm-hmm. I think it's Cleveley's athletics track. It's called just by the motorway. So if you went down to the track kind of any night of the week, there would be some sort of form of athletics going on there to get into Monday. I think most train on all three train either on a Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday or Thursday. So there's opportunities to get involved with all four clubs in the region.
Yeah, and absolutely. And with the great respect to other sports in the Olympics, athletics, I think in one sense is almost like the showpiece in some respects, Nick, the 100 metres and so on and so forth. When the athletics comes along, it really appeals to huge audiences. And you mentioned there that training throughout the week, and if you sort of give us an insight in terms of the effort the clubs put throughout the season and what it sort of takes for an athlete and for clubs to sort of to build the infrastructure. You know, we all love to see the athletes perform really well, and you know, many years ago in 2012, that Super Saturday was a phenomenal occasion. And what goes on behind the scenes, the hard work, Nick? You mentioned volunteering opportunities, and what's it like to, you know, for a club to sort of keep things going, and coaches and so on and so forth? How much work's involved behind the scenes throughout the year?
Yeah, I think it's a great question, and I think there's a perception out there that some athletics clubs are kind of professionally run with paid members of staff and so on. So the four clubs which I've mentioned are all voluntary based clubs. So it's a bit like, say, if you take your son to a local football team and you've got a dad who's a coach. Very, very similar to exactly the same as an athletics club, really. You know, they're a family community organisation, really welcoming to people to come down. I think some people maybe get a view that it's for the elitist as such, but I would kind of argue with that. Where definitely the four clubs which I've mentioned have a beginner's kind of section or a social section arm of the club. So it's not kind of actually you need to be running a certain time or, you know, or throwing a certain distance. It's kind of we class ourselves as one of our vision is being one of the most inclusive sports in the country or in the world at athletics and running. So we're a big advocate of that. But going back to kind of the question about the time and effort, yeah, you've got kind of a real hard knit working group of volunteers giving up their free time and putting their blood and sweat into the athletics club. So I met quite recently Salford Met. I met Jack and Brett from the club. I think the committee members at the club, and they've got kind of a vision of refurbing the track with support with Salford Leisure Trust, who own the track, which is kind of a community trust arm of the council, and they want to kind of plant trees. So they want to kind of make the environment really, really welcoming for people. And I'm sure the other two clubs utilising that track will be in supportive of Salford Met doing that. But I've just got a lot of. A lot of gratitude for these guys just making the sport work. To be honest, without them, we've got no sport at the end of the day. I'm here kind of as a sounding board, a bit of advice, and I'd come in and help them. But unfortunately, they're probably with me. I probably couldn't. Do what the volunteers are doing with 130 clubs, which I support. It's quite a difficult task to do that. But the guys at the clubs are fantastic, I've just got so much time for them.
Absolutely. No, I think one thing about athletics, that's for sure, there's a strong camaraderie, and I think that certainly in that environment you make friends for life, and there's a really, really strong bond, even though athletes do compete against each other away from competition. There's a lot of good friendships that are made, and I think for me, for the local community, it can only be a good thing to get people involved in various levels. And whether you run 100 metres in 10 seconds or 20 seconds, there's a place for everybody, I think, in athletics or in track and field in general. One thing that I think, Nick, is the variable in sports between coaching, qualified coaching, and performance level. In a lot of sports, we see the more coaches that are trained and get qualified and experienced, the better generally that sports do well. We've seen that across the world in different sports, where when there's been a focus on providing coach training, then that's formed a strong variable to increase the performance level. You mentioned coach development workshops yourselves. Is that something that you guys are consciously mindful of helping coaches learn, and obviously a lot of them got a lot of experience and they bring a lot to the party in that way, but just having some formalized understanding through coaching education of development and long-term development plans, just generally areas that they might enhance their ability. What are some things that you do around the sort of coach development stuff?
One we've got on tonight, actually, down in Bolton, so it's not a million miles away from Salford. We've got a road running workshop for road running coaches or leaders. So that's talking about preparation and recovery. So we've got a sort of a lead tutor who's going to come in, a two-hour kind of session. We've got about 20 people booked onto that from the Northwest. A few from Manchester area as well, which is great. There's that example where we've got one happening tonight, but we've got one in Warrington happening in March for the track and field kind of coaches. We have we call them kind of regional or event days, where we'll hold it on a Saturday afternoon or a Saturday day, and it'll be kind of all qualified coaches coming to meet up and kind of get CPD. So they might be coming with a sprint background or a throws background. There'll be items out there. So we have a website called Athletics Hub. So if you kind of Google that, that'll come up. That'll give you kind of a list of what coaching qualifications there are within ourselves. So you've got kind of coach education, and then you've got coach development. So there's two kind of elements you can look at. So if you're not qualified, there's going to be something for you to get onto the ladder. So you might go on to an assistant athletics coaching course, or you might become a run leader. So there's kind of two types of avenues you can go down. So if you're more of a runner or in a running club, you can go down the kind of the run leader and then become a coach in running fitness. Or if you're a want to be an athletics coach, then you'd be the assistant coach, then you'd be the athletics coach. So that's kind of like level one, level two in easy terms. So there's that for the education, and then for the development, we've got a stream of different workshops and so on. We're actually doing webinars at the moment for kind of coaches and clubs as well. So kind of some committee members. So we had one last night, and that was for managing large groups. So it was kind of so obviously we've got kind of coaches out there or clubs out there who will probably have large groups to manage. So this, we got a club to come in and just to illustrate what they were doing, good practice wise. So it was only a short, sharp hour. They did it. We had about 25 people booked onto the webinar. Went down really, really well. So we've got a few more webinars coming up. So another topic on the webinar would be how to set up a junior section. And then the other one was how to recruit volunteers and retain volunteers was another one. But they're more focused towards road running clubs, these three. And before Christmas, we ran six webinars focused on track and field clubs as well. So there's a lot of development. Even if you don't want to go out of your house, you can access some form of development through England Athletics.
Yeah, that's really interesting stuff. And you know, we've seen the internet have a big impact in organisations in general, and it sounds like it's had an impact on English Athletics in terms of the way you can sort of reach out to people and provide different opportunities to learn and watch and see what's going on. And in terms of getting involved, I know you mentioned a few details there, but is there any other way that that people sort of listening in who are wondering how they can sort of look at things and maybe get involved? Are there different sort of, I know you mentioned one website there, but is there any other websites as well, Nick, that people can sort of like tune in and maybe watch a webinar or get in touch about volunteering or anything like that at all?
So, yeah, I was going to say if we've got a listener on the call who's been inspired and wants to join an athletics club or a running club locally, we've got on our England Athletics website a club finder. So regardless if you live in the Salford area or you live in Southport or wherever, you can just basically type your postcode in. It'll locate the nearest club to you, and then you can kind of go direct to the club then. So if you did want to get involved, that would probably be the best way to go forward. On the other hand, if you're local in the Salford area and you've got them three clubs, they've all got websites. So if you just kind of type in Google Salford Met AC, Swinton Road Running Club, or Salford Harriers, I'm sure that they would be more than happy to kind of accept some volunteers and helpers, wanting to get involved with in athletics, either participant or kind of a volunteer.
Absolutely, that's really interesting stuff, and it'd be sort of great to hear more around the participation programs as well. But in terms of your own role, Nick, in terms of you support the clubs in and around the Northwest, obviously there's a lot of clubs. You mentioned that there are other people, other support managers throughout the country. Do you liaise with other people in the same role as yourself or similar roles throughout the country? Do you sort of bounce off ideas and to move things forward? And or how does that generally work in terms of English Athletics, obviously being throughout the country in terms of your own role? Is that something that you do? Or
we have a strong bond in our team. We've got we meet once a month. where we have kind of a team meeting, kind of review our work programs and so on. I feel that we've got a really joined up approach. So what I'm delivering in sort of the Northwest region, there will be the equivalent to me in the Northeast or in the Midlands or kind of in the Southwest. They'll be doing a very, very similar, giving a very similar offer to the clubs, going back to kind of the three elements I said to the job before, whether it be bespoke projects, servicing the club, or doing a club review for that particular club. So there's kind of that's how we kind of move forward as a team. And then going, like, if we take the webinars, for example, that's a joint team effort. I lead on it from our team's point of view, but each webinar has been kind of developed by one of the club support managers nationally and then delivered. But yeah, so we kind of chip in and go. So yeah, so it's a real strong knit team we've got in England Athletics.
Interesting stuff, and it's so great to hear that English Athletics is in a good place in that respect. And it's great to see, obviously, athletes participate at the highest level, and I think certainly on TV it's received and receiving more coverage throughout the year, and different championships are being screened and so on and so forth. But equally, in saying that, I think we mustn't forget that obviously athletics is for all, and irrespective of what level you are, anyone can participate and just find their own level. With yourself, Nick, do you sort of liaise with just the, I mean, who do you liaise with yourself at the clubs? Do you contact athletes as well, or is it just the coaches, or how
does it work? My kind of direct contact will be probably the committee. So it'll be, for me, it'd be like the leadership of that club. I will have that connection with. Don't get me wrong, I will speak to kind of coaches and so on. So, and that'll probably be more, say that the conversations with the coaches would be more directing them to the development workshops and so on. But the real kind of meaty work, what I get into, will be with a chair or a secretary of the club, or a volunteer coordinator. So it just depends, really. Each club's different and unique in their own way. So I might have a really strong sort of connection with or relationship with a certain position within a club, but it might be a totally different position within another club. So there's no kind of right or wrong answer. There's no kind of I must work with, say, the membership secretary, for argument's sake. It's anybody within the club who wants to develop the club, I'm more than happy. But it'll probably be more towards a committee member.
And did they speak to you about various forms of support that you can offer, Nick? Is that how it generally works in terms of the committee? Will they sort of put a case forward in terms of what they require potential assistance with to move the club forward?
Yeah, it can be a bit of a proactive reactive. I prefer to kind of go down the proactive approach, where we can kind of discuss with the club and have a detailed discussion to say, right, what are you doing? Maybe I might come down for a club visit to see them in action and give them some advice on that. Sometimes I just get a club going, you know, would contact me out of the blue and say, Nick, really need this support with this particular topic. Can you help? If I and again, I'm not the aura of all knowledge, but if I don't know the answer, I'll find the answer for the club, if that makes sense. I'm just basically here to help and support the clubs be as successful as they can and sustainable as they can, really.
And when you say like success and sustainable, what would be the benchmark? Obviously every club's different, but what would be a general benchmark, Nick, for say success and sustainable in terms of a club? Obviously, you know, you've mentioned some really strong clubs traditionally in the south of the area, and they've sort of produced some great athletes over the years and have had stability. What would you say would be a reasonable benchmark for a club in terms of what's their sort of wish list in terms of their own vision? Obviously, we'd all like to produce world-class athletes, but that's obviously, you know, it takes time and patience, dedication. But what are some of the criteria for success for a club, Nick?
Good question. I would say it's kind of a combination, really. And again, you've kind of alluded to, depends on what type of club I'm working with. But I would say a successful club would have a strong committee. So they're very open and transparent with the members. They've got that kind of good relationship with them. They've got a strong membership base. That always helps. If you've got more people, you've got more revenue coming in to be more sustainable. You've got some good quality coaches within there. And when I say good quality coaches, I don't mean maybe at the performance end. I might mean potentially at the junior end, where they've got a really welcoming environment and people want to be at that club. I think for me it's all about the culture and the philosophy at the club. If you've got a really good culture and people are bought into it, I think that's kind of the snowball effect, really. If you don't have that kind of welcoming and happy and everyone's singing off the same hymn sheet, it sounds simple, but it's very, very hard work to get it to. Absolutely. But once you've got it, it's potentially quite easy to maintain in a way. Yeah. So for me, it's probably not what type of facility they've got, or if they've got top quality coaches. It's probably more that environment, that kind of friendly and open environment at the club, I would kind of pin my hat on.
Absolutely. That's a great point. I think it's, really, I mean, obviously some great work done over the years, England Athletics, and the thing is, I suppose with any sport, any organisation, and not suggesting that England Athletics would ever rest on their laurels in that respect, but I think it's really important to keep, people like yourself, that, keep, obviously, every confidence with people like yourself doing the roles that you do to keep moving things forward. And do you think that's important, Nick, that development keeps going forward and keep looking for new ways and innovative ways, like the webinars, like getting people involved in various levels and sort of keep the times? Is that a big, really important thing, do you think, to sort of keep the momentum going, but also not necessarily revolution, but evolution as an organization?
Yeah, I think you're right. I think we're always learning. I've kind of got a teaching background, and I'm a big believer, and a coaching background. And I'm a big believer, once you stop kind of learning, that's kind of where you start breaking down. You continuously need to do kind of your plan, do review, and keep on going. For me, that's kind of my I'm a big believer of keep it simple. So if we can kind of stick to, I always try and stick to that model, and if it's working, still review it because I'm sure even if it's fantastic, there might be something what you might need to tweak, or there might be something what crops up in the future which you do need to change. So yeah, it's changing landscape definitely within the sports development industry in the last kind of 15 years. What I've been in the sport industry, it's changed quite a lot, I would say.
And that's really interesting stuff. And I think, like he says, Nick, I think the having the support there for the club is obviously really important on various levels, and providing a nice, safe, welcoming environment for people to participate, friendly environment. Is paramount. But it's been a pleasure having you on the show, Nick. I'm sure the listeners have really was really interested, some of the listeners, and no doubt inspired people to get involved. So just before you sort of, I know you sort of mentioned it before, but before you shoot off, you can just remind the listeners, if they want to get involved, what the main website to go to volunteer for coach education, that they can get in touch, as well as the Salford clubs, the England Athletic website.
Of course, yeah. So the coaching one is called Athletics Hub. So it's just www.athleticshub.co.uk. So that's a nice, easy one. Then the other one, what I mentioned, where you've got the four clubs, which is Salford Met AC, Swinton Road Running Club, Salford Harriers, and Barton AC. They've all got the website, so if you just Google one of them, their website will come straight up. And then we've got a club finder, so if you're not from the Salford area, you've got www.englandathletics.org/find-athletics@club. So, or if you just Google find an athletics club, you'd be able to get to that page.
That's fantastic, Nick. We really appreciate you coming on board the show, Salford City Radio 94.4 FM, with your host Jim Petruzzi on the Friday Sports Show. Nick Settle, the club support manager of England Athletics in the Northwest, and you know, it's an important role. And if anyone listening, do get in touch. And certainly one of the aims of the show is to increase awareness and participation of sports, and athletics is one of those sports that we all love to watch at the Olympics. But throughout the year, there's so much hard work being done by people like Nick, who's been kind enough to come on board the show, and the many volunteers up and down the country and in the Northwest. Nick, thanks again for coming on board the show, and no doubt we'll speak to you again sometime.
Thanks, mate. See you soon.
So you're listening to Salford City Radio 94.4 FM, your host Jimmy Petruzzi on the Friday Sports Show, bringing you all the latest news from the local area and around the world with the view of increasing awareness and participation of different sports. One of the sports that certainly I am and many of the listeners are passionate about is athletics, and we watch athletics on TV, and particularly during the Olympic Games, the Olympic year this year, and we all cast their mind back to Super Saturday in 2012. Was a phenomenal experience to watch. But equally, in saying that, there's a lot of people behind the scenes who do a lot of hard work. We interview many world-class athletes on the show across different sports, and sometimes we can forget that there's so many people doing so much hard work behind the scenes. And today, Dan Parkinson, who's the head of participation programs of the English Athletics, is going to speak to us in more detail about what goes on in various programs to participate in athletics. Dan, welcome to the show. Great to have you on board.
Thanks, Jim. Good to be here.
Fantastic. Dan, tell us a bit about what you do, the head of participation programs. Our listeners are probably wondering, what does one do? No doubt there's many things that you do, and you know, we could probably dedicate a whole show on that. But in a nutshell, what do you do in your role?
So I look after participation programs. So I think the easiest way to explain that is we focus a lot of our attention on trying to encourage more people to run, but also to take part in track and field. From my perspective, from a running point of view, we have a program called Run Together, which encourages people to connect with other people. It's mainly aimed at runners who'd like to run with other people. So we've got a lot of insight across the country, and we know that people are probably motivated to run in three different ways. So you've got people that are motivated to maybe run on their own, so they might be from the, you know, leaving their house and going for a run on their own. And we've also got people that are motivated to run with other people, so that could be really informally going for a run with your friend, or a bit more formally at a group or a club, so with a number of other people. And then third kind of person that we know that runs is someone that predominantly is motivated to run because of an event. So that could be they go to the local park run, or it could actually be that they're training for, you know, say the London Marathon. Now, what we probably decided to do is there's lots and lots of people that run already. So I think at the minute there's around 7 million people across the country that run on a regular basis, which is a lot of people. And also, there are loads and loads of organisations that offer running activity. So I think when we did some recent research, there was over 100,000 different types of provider that offer running activity. So our strategy is really about that middle group of people that I mentioned, so people that are motivated to run with other people. We developed a program called Run Together, which was launched in 2017, so I think it's three years old now. And that program, the main aim is it's just a way of connecting people together. So within it, you've got a few different ways that you can get involved. So you've got run together groups, which are local running groups across the country, so many in Salford and, you know, the Manchester area. But the idea is that someone trains up to be a run leader. So we have a one-day course someone goes on to, and once they've been on that course, which is called the Leadership in Running Fitness course, they're in effect able to take out a group of local people for a run. And so they're giving advice and tools and tips to do that. Now, we've got over 2,500 groups across the country that are led by volunteers, really, who've trained up in that qualification. What we do as an organisation is we try and help those people that are leading runs. So we provide them with free tools through the Run Together website. So they get a free website to use. They've got an app that they can use that helps them manage bookings. So it basically makes their life a bit easier to then focus on, you know, having a good time and so on. But in the last 3 years, we've seen, I think it's just over 125,000 people join that community, which is, you know, is brilliant. But ultimately, it's driven by local people that, you know, give up the time to go and take people. So that's one of the things connected to Run Together. I suppose the second thing is around the work that we do on mental health. So it's a big topic, as we know, across the country. We've got a program which is called Hashtag Run and Talk. So it's about encouraging people to talk about mental health, but also to try and do some exercise at the same time. So we have a number of volunteers, again, across the country, they're called Mental Health Champions. And they basically give up their time within those groups that I referenced and also the affiliated clubs that we've got. They basically give up their time and just talk about the benefits of, you know, having positive mental health and running and so on. So we tie that into different events, which is great. So that's the second part of it. And then the third part really is the work that we do with visually impaired people. So we've got a program called Find a Guide. So we train up lots of people who become a guide runner. So again, they go on a sight loss and awareness course, which is a one-day course. And once they've done that, they can go and take people out for a run. So people visit our website and try and find one of the guide runners, and then they go out for a run with someone else. So I think that all three of those kind of almost programs in one program are ways that we try and encourage people, you know, to do something and get active. Mm. I suppose the one common thing that they've got though is that they're all interested in doing something with, you know, someone else.
Mm. That's really interesting stuff, Dan. There's a sort of perception around, at least I think, athletics is being obviously, I wouldn't necessarily like elite as in sport, but we think of athletics and we think of some of the big names in sport and in this country. In England, we've been very fortunate in GB to produce so many great athletes over the years, but here we're sort of looking at the other end of the scale, if you could call it that, or spectrum anyway, where anyone can get involved. And I think for me, some of the initiatives you guys do are fantastic and have a big social effect for people to be able to get out there and speak to people and just, you know, the fresh air and be out there. What are some of the distances that the running involves, Dan? I mean, what sort of, when you sort of mentioned that they're running, what sort of distances, you mentioned obviously up to marathon, but what are some of the distances that you guys
want to do that with other people? So that's kind of the common the common thing around that. But I think the distances vary. I think the good thing about what the leaders and the groups offer are, there's quite a wide range of opportunities. So within the website, you can kind of filter on what distance you're after. And it's quite an inclusive program, I think, because you can ultimately just start running or be at the be at the other spectrum.
Yeah, and that's really interesting stuff. And just sort of for our listeners who may be interested, and we live in a really sporting community and we're surrounded with some great sporting infrastructures in this area and some strong sporting traditions and many, many great volunteers and great athletic clubs in the area. Now, for people to get involved, what's the sort of first thing they would do, generally speaking, if they listening to you speak, Dan, and think, well, I'd like to maybe get involved as a run leader? What are some of the things that they could, what's some of the first steps they could do to maybe get involved?
So there's probably two ways that you could get involved. So one is by visiting runtogether.co.uk. So on there, you'd be able to search for local groups, and you'd also be able to find out information about how you could become a run leader. So that's definitely a good place to start if you're looking at putting your trainers on and going for a run. And then secondly, if you're interested in potentially some of the track and field activity or from our road running clubs or something a bit more formal, you could visit the England Athletics website, and on there there's a club finder tool which helps you find what local clubs are in the area. And also on there, you'd be able to find out information for the next leadership in running fitness courses. So again, if you wanted to be a run leader, for instance, you could go on there and find out a bit more. So that's englandathletics.co.uk.
And that's really interesting stuff in terms of accessibility. I can imagine, in one sense, taking that initial step for some people could be not necessarily intimidating, but you sort of take that sort of step out there and, you know, you're on the way. But equally, in saying that, Dan, the other end of the spectrum, let's say someone shows potential. Now, I know this is sort of geared up towards inclusion and getting people involved and participating, but if someone does sort of show potential, untapped potential, so to speak, is there a process they could use to work on that and perhaps not necessarily get to the very top, but go as far as they can go as a participant?
Yeah, definitely. So I think that, again, there's a few ways that you could do it. I think what we see is a lot of people that are really trying to improve their running and go further, join a club. So you could join a local club. Again, if you go to the England Athletics website, you can search for a list of local clubs. And I think what you'll find at those sessions are you can still take part in your weekly runs, but you kind of get more opportunity to work with coaches on a one-to-one basis, and I think they would put in place various training plans to move you forward. So that's one way that I would definitely encourage. And then there are other opportunities then to compete at competitions and so on. So as you start to get a bit more interested, again, the first place you'd start is probably with a club, but after that there are opportunities to then go off into competitions as you progress and so on. So I suppose there's lots of different ways, but I would certainly start off by visiting a website and finding a local club. And I think once you get down to a club, by speaking to people who are involved at the club and other runners, you'd soon be able to find out the relevant information that you need to kind of point in the next step for yourself and so on. So that's what I would recommend as a start, at the least.
Yeah, absolutely. And I'm sure some of the listeners listening in have a variable degree of ability, and not everyone has the aspiration to be at the very highest level, but I suppose many people want to be the best they can be. Or like you mentioned before, I think one of the great initiatives about the program that you mentioned is just getting out, the social aspect. Do you get feedback on how that impacts people? I can only imagine, Dan, that for some people who, from a social point of view, I know it can be difficult sometimes getting out there, but do you sort of get feedback from people in terms of how it's impacted their life, just sort of getting out there and having someone to bounce a few ideas off and just running? And it's almost like you speak to someone, but on top of that also you get the benefit physiologically, so you get the physiological benefit and the mind benefit too. Do you get feedback from people and stories about how it impacts people's lives in that respect?
Yeah, definitely. I think one of the things that we're fortunate about is because it's such an inclusive activity and at times quite a low cost activity, there's so many people that it's had a positive impacts on the life, whether that be through you know, positive impact on their mental health, or actually it's about them, you know, working through a challenge that they're going through, and actually it's just a bit of a distraction and so on. So I think, you know, we're inundated on a daily basis through social media and through, you know, communications that we have with the runners involved in the community about personal impacts. A good thing that we do on the website is we try and capture people's personal stories. So we've got lots of personal stories that have come from the community. And I think one of the things that we encourage people to do when they're thinking about running is actually, you know, look at some of the other stories of people, because actually you can probably see something in your own situation that someone's, you know, gone through, or a similarity and so on. So I think they're certainly thing. The other thing that I would say about Run Together as well, and getting involved in the community, is I think when you go along to a local session or a group and you start meeting people, I've noticed this certainly, because every month we go and visit a group across the country and, you know, find out how it's going for them, and you know, find out some of these stories. Like personally, when I've been to see some of the group, they're quite, you know, welcoming and, you know, and opening it. You almost feel part of the group after one run, don't you? And
I think if
you think about, like, sports and sessions, as someone who's got young children, I'm already encouraging them to go and, you know, get involved in running and other activities, because I think one of the great things about sport and physical activities, people that are like-minded and welcoming, and so it's really, you know, it's really positive in terms of, like, helping them. And I think when I've gone round and, you know, spoken to people, you start running round with them, and they're telling you their own personal, you know, details and you know, how they're going and so on. And you would never get that if you just, you know, turned up to a place or so on. So I do think that people let the guard down.
Yeah, the barriers
a lot
come down. Absolutely.
Absolutely.
What I find interesting, and I mean, athletics has always been a huge interest of mine, and I've been fortunate myself to have sort of trained some great coaches many, many years ago, probably before all the listeners' times. And the thing for me, one thing that sort of strikes me, Dan, is the changes. I mean, athletics in general has always been a welcoming place. There's always been a lot of camaraderie. You've always been able to get in touch with coaches to sort of help you out and perhaps give you a few tips along the way. And I've been, you know, very fortunate over the years, my remit as a mental skills and conditioning coach, to sort of bounce ideas, and they've always been open and to generate ideas. But one thing that strikes me, and it might be my own ignorance, I don't know, is that it seems to me there's a lot more programs these days around the local communities, like the one you've mentioned. Is that something that you guys have worked hard on? Is just my own sort of not recognizing or seeing that? Is that something that sort of you guys are really pushed over the last few years? I'm sort of going back a good 20 years or so ago, where I don't think some of these programs sort of existed in this way. Is that something that consciously you guys have developed, or?
I think so. I think a lot of it is a few years ago. I joined the organization 4 years ago, and I think at the time we started to develop a greater understanding of the running market and athletics market, and we've got a lot of insight in the organisation that we've taken from what we can find out there, and we kind of know a lot about people's motivations and why, you know, they're dropping in and out of activity and why they join and so on. And I think what we've tried to do is do a lot of consultation over the last few years to try and find out genuinely what activities people want. So I think if you take the example of Run Together that we gave, when we developed that 3 years ago, that ultimately was developed by run leaders. All we did is go out and speak to them and find out, you know, how they wanted support, or what other incentives they wanted to, you know, to get involved, or initiatives that would help and so on. So I think we've reacted to what we know about people's motivations and feelings and so on, and use that insight to basically try and come up with programs that we think help people. So I think, yeah, absolutely, we've got a lot more understanding of what. And I think the other thing is, you're starting to see the change, aren't you, in terms of how people almost consume activity. So I think people have got, like, personally myself, like, I've got a young family. Time's precious, isn't it? You want to spend time with your your family and so on. And if you see initiatives like Park Runs, another great example, isn't it? If mm-hmm. you can go down on a Saturday or something, you know, with your family, and you've gone for a run in half an hour to an hour, and then you can do the rest of your day and so on. So I think naturally, by looking at things like that, or going for a group run in a week, you can fit in busy lifestyles around it. So I think we've tried to come up with programs and things that work around, you know, busy lives and taking, because ultimately people have told us that they've not got a lot of time to do stuff. So I think naturally you'll see that. And then the other thing is, like, if you look at the way that technology's moving and digital, I think how people search for things as well has changed drastically, hasn't it? So I think you know, local community provision is absolutely you know, fundamental for people moving, but how you find out about that information is key. And I think you will see lots of sports investing in digital systems to try and get you know, to basically make it as easy as possible for you to go and do something. And I think if you look, if you only have to look at what, you know, the food industry's done over the last you know, few years about making it really easy for you to go and eat food, I think sport's kind of doing the same, isn't it? We all want people to be active and so on, so we need to kind of diversify what we're doing and so on. So we've definitely made a conscious effort, and obviously with the fact that over 100,000 people are now doing something, I think it shows that it's a good approach to take, isn't it?
No, it's incredible, and certainly from the outside looking in, that looks evident, and that takes a lot of hard work and determination to get there. And do you find that when there's a world championship on, or Olympic year, and some of the really well-known athletes do well, does that sort of drive participation up? Maybe people watching some of the, and we're very fortunate in this country to have some great names in the sport, but when say you sort of watch on TV and see some great performances, does that sort of influence participation as well there?
Yeah, definitely. I think we, if you take another one of our programs, so we've got a program that we're trying at the minute to try and encourage 4 to 11-year-olds to take part in athletics, so almost like an introduction into the sport. It's called Phonetics, so fun athletics, and that's going across the country. We're lucky to work with Katarina Johnson Thompson on that, so obviously she, you know, she's continuing to do, you know, really well, and hopefully she does well at the part way through this year. So I think when you see someone like that on TV, you know, you ask questions about how they got involved in that. So I think wherever you can utilise people that have, like Katarina, who started at a local club in Liverpool, or you know, he came from the Northwest and so on, you can kind of relate to that. So I think the more that you can leverage, that is certainly important. And I think, you know, other examples whereby I've seen, like my wife, for instance, she doesn't necessarily do a lot of activity, but whenever we're watching, say, you know, the London Marathon on TV, I'm not saying she's going to go and run a marathon, but I think naturally you're almost spurred on to go
do something,
aren't you? Even if you don't run a marathon, you almost feel guilty that day that you've not gone for a run and so on. So it's like subconsciously nudging you to
be a bit more healthy. I mean, you mentioned Phonetics there, and that's a really interesting concept. How does one get involved in that, Dan? Phonetics, is there a way to get involved? Let's say you've got, you know, young families listening, and or maybe people got grandkids or children, or they're considering bringing down. And I think that's a great initiative, by the way, in the way it's done. And certainly, you know, traditionally, at least in my experience, I think back to athletics many years ago, it was a little bit different for younger people getting involved. It was pretty tough in that respect. Phonetics is great, but how does one get involved in Phonetics? Where do they go to find out more about that?
So again, you can go onto the website. So there's a website called phonetics.co.uk, and you can search for your local session. And so we're currently working with a range of providers across the country. So that could be within a school or a club or a community environment. So we're currently training those up to kind of put sessions on later this year, which will tie into the Olympics as well, when we promote it a bit more. And so initially, for parents thinking about it, they can go onto the website and find out information about it. They can also register their interest in the programme. They can find out information on the England Athletics website about it. But yeah, that would be the first step. I think the main point of the programme is it's just about trying to get children to run, jump and throw more. Yeah. So we know that if someone starts to, you know, to practice running, jumping and throwing, that whatever sport they end up in, it's going to put them in a better,
absolutely,
you know, position and
absolutely.
So on. It's one of the, you know, it's fundamentals of movement and
long
so on.
Time,
and actually, yeah, you know, jumping in the sand and just, you know, running and so on. So it's fun games that they can take part in. Sessions are quite quick. They're led by trained coaches across the country. And yeah, we just think at the minute we notice that the majority of people join an athletics club from the age of 8, and we think that actually we could bring that age forward, because we know that there's like 4, 5, 6, 7 year olds that are doing similar activity at school and actually want to,
absolutely,
you know, go and learn to run, jump and throw. So yeah, so that initiative's come back on the basis of that. So yeah, so look out more for that this year. There'll be more information,
interesting
on
stuff
that.
And is that sort of tying to any sort of talent ID as well, Dan, or is that sort of in terms of like identification of talent and long-term athletic development plans, is that sort of an area that if someone does show exceptional ability, then are there opportunities for them to sort of move forward and maybe go into more of an elitist group?
I think the basis of the program ultimately is about fun, so it's more about just encouraging them to move a bit more. And I think the basis though is definitely linked into long term athlete development. So one of the things that children do is there are different coloured stages that they progress through.
Okay.
So you know, like how you do swimming lessons and you get better at different badges.
Yeah.
It's the same principle. So there's 6 coloured stages. You start at red stage. And what happens is on a weekly basis when you're taking part in these activities, so if it's running, jumping and throwing, what you'll do is you'll do fun games, but you'll basically do gradually harder games. So you'll become more competent at an activity. And what a coach is able to do is, from almost a physical literacy point of view, is we can then start to track how that child's getting better. So you're tracked through an app and it shows how you're, you know, almost progressing through the stage. What we hope, say, is if you fast forward in, you know, 10, 15 years' time, that the next Katarina Johnson Thompson, you could see how they had progressed through the various competency stages throughout the life. So it's all about fun games and activities.
Absolutely.
But actually it's about tracking the impact, in a similar way that when my child goes to nursery and I find out how he's getting better at, you know, reading or writing, it's exactly the same. It's just we can start to tell a parent about how your child's becoming better at, you know, running, jumping and throwing.
Absolutely. And the confidence that it sort of gives the young children to be able to do that. And I think that is certainly transferable into other areas of their life, including academia as well. But it's been fascinating, Dan. It really has. Interviewing you, it's gone really, really quick, and no doubt we'll speak again sometime. So I really want to thank you for coming on board the show. Dan Parkinson, Head of Participation Programs for English Athletics, has given us a fascinating insight into what's going on, and we could have spoke for however long, really. But thanks again for coming on board the show, Dan. I've really found it interesting. I'm sure the listeners have too, and no doubt they'll you know, be in touch through the various channels you provided if they want to get involved. Thanks again, Dan.
No problem. Thank you.
So you're listening to Salford City Radio 94.4 FM, the Friday Sports Show of your host Jimmy Petruzzi, and that was Dan Parkinson, Head of Participation Programs for English Athletics. Thanks for listening, and no doubt you found that really interesting, and you know, do get in touch or email the show if you've got any questions or comments about anything that's Dan covered, and you're looking to get on board as a volunteer or in any capacity that works for you. We'll definitely forward you the details to the various websites provided. Thanks for listening.